الحمد لله رب العالمين الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله الحمد لله الذي أنزل الفرقان على عبده ليكون للعالمين نذيرا والصلاة والسلام على خير خلق ونور أرش أفضل الأنبياء والمرسلين حبيبنا وسيدنا وسندنا وشفيعنا ومولانا أبي القاسم محمد وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المظلومين أما بعد فقد قال الله سبحانه وتعالى في كتاب المجيد وقوله الحق وهو أصدق الصادقين بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وأقيموا الوزن بالقسط ولا تخسروا الميزان صدق الله العلي العظيم صلوات على محمد وآل محمد I begin in Allah's name, the beneficent, the merciful. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us with this existence and has granted us this life by which to test us, and He has given us the ability to understand the power of balance. Because at the end of the day, we realize, even in physical sciences, that when things reach equilibrium, tranquility, that these terminologies, peace, these all are really the same connotations implying something that is balanced, something that is not disturbing, something that is within the system of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bring things into equilibrium. This world is a very contradictory world. It's a very complicated world. We have to admit that. As much as we try to present clear arguments forward, each and every one of us is a product of an experience that cannot be experienced by any other human being. And as much as we share commonalities in terms of our happiness and sadness and desires and lack thereof, we all agree that each one of us is an individual being made of our own understanding in the environment that we were raised in. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the only one who knows what lies dormant in our souls. Rabbukum a'lamu bima fi nufusikum. Allah knows what lies in every soul. And only Allah is the one who is the master of the Day of Judgment. Only He is the one who is capable of granting everything its perfect, perfect due. We'll talk about these dues today for that judgment. How should we as human beings, as believing human beings, as submissive human beings, ones who want to stand upright in this very transient world, how can we achieve that balance by which to be happy, to have inner peace and tranquility and cause happiness for others without being a burden upon others? And it's a very fine line which requires you and I to constantly reflect, to constantly think, to constantly question, to constantly validate that as we're getting older, our environments are changing, our scenarios are changing, our judgments are changing, our wisdom hopefully is getting broader and wider and getting more stable, and our faith is becoming stronger, hopefully. And all these combinations, hopefully, will lead us to better judgments. That's what life is all about. Really, when you put it at the bottom line, that's what it's all about. Regardless of what faith we belong to, we as Muslims are blessed to be given the correct religion. And I say this, I know that everyone would say that. Quran says, "Kullu hizbin bima ladayhim farihun." Every army fights for its own cause. And if a Christian were to stand up there, he would say, we are the right religion. Agreed. I agree with that. But I say that on a scale of usul, in terms of fundamental principles of belief in God, definition of God, who is Allah? How do we understand Allah? How do we put together all the factors of understanding the parameters of why we exist? For example, the explanation of the problem of evil. The explanation. What is the understanding of why evil exists? Since Allah is all good, God is all good, why did He create evil? Why did He allow it to be so pervasive? Why did He allow it to be so prevalent in our societies? For there's a contradiction here, that as much as I want to submit to an almighty good God, I am surrounded with evil forces trying to take me away from God. How about that contradiction? How do I reconcile that? These are all matters of discussion that take time for it to settle in our minds. And the snippets and the answers are given in the Quran, they're given in the Sunnah of Rasulullah. Many a times they're given even in lectures, but they pass us many a times and we don't grab them and sit on it and think about it. So these are all matters that I'm bringing forth. that we all have to have comprehension for. For when we proactively struggle to understand, it's the best thing we can do. If there is one word that Allah loves the most when it comes to human transaction, it's called struggle. Ya ayyuha al-insan, innaka kadihun ila rabbika kadhan famulaqi. Mankind, oh mankind, keep struggling. Keep struggling. Struggling is healthy, it's good. But not foolish struggling, productive struggling, efficient struggling, where we struggle to uncover the onion skins so that we know the true nature of why we exist on this earth and to know what the true parameters of life is. All the parameters of life are. And for us to understand what is media telling us, what is society telling us, what are the pundits telling us, what are the prevalent explanations of religion out there, even within Islam, and how much of that is true and how much of that is fabricated. Unfortunately, even in the best school of thought, which is the Ja'fari school of thought, there are actions and transactions that we as Muslims do that do not belong within the prescriptions of Islam. Because we have absorbed them culturally and they've become part of the fabric of our religion. And people can argue this way and that way, but that is what Allah has left upon us. That as much as it has intruded into your lifestyle, because Allah has made a system that I cannot separate my culturalism from my ideology. My cultural lifestyle and the things that I do and my modes of expression of love and hatred are inseparable from my ideology, and hence every once in a while, no religion is free from what we call cultural intonations. And culture is very healthy. There is nothing wrong with culture. Culture should be promoted. Language of our nations that we've come from should be promoted. Our children should learn their motherland tongue. Must. Because language is an entry into knowledge. It's a gateway to knowledge. Even Allah says in the Quran, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِنْ رَسُولٍ إِلَّا بِلِسَانِ قَوْمِ لِيُبَيِّنَ لَهُمْ. We never sent messengers except by the language of its people so that they can explain it to them clearly. So language is important, and the more languages we know, the more access we have. And culture is very healthy. Even Allah says, right? يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ إِنَّا خَلَقْنَاكُمْ مِنْ ذَكَرٍ وَأُنْثَى وَجَعَلْنَاكُمْ شُعُوبًا وَقَبَائِلَ لِتَعَارَفُوا. Oh mankind, we made you male and female, nations and tribes, so you know each other. لِتَعَارَفُوا. These cultural diversities, it's a spice to life. Variations of people eating different foods, it's a spice to life. These are wonderful things. Let's not eradicate them. No human being can eradicate culture, by the way, because the amalgamation of cultures is still a culture. And the diversity of cultures is still a culture. You cannot escape that. So I'm here to say very clearly that culture should be maintained, but not at the cost of infiltrating some cultural actions that violate Islam. For if they do, then it must be removed. There is no tolerance for violation of principles in the garb of culture. This is something that must be very carefully be observed, because when we bring such things into our systems and they are in gross violation of the Quran, if they're in gross violation of the Quran. Remember, there are fine lines. People say, for example, a woman wearing hijab in certain parts of the world wears a certain color. Another woman wears a different color, a different style in another part of the world. All those are good, with the condition that the principles of hijab are maintained. Food. Cook any food you want, as long as the ingredients are halal. And the acquisition of the food was halal. So notice, the varieties are endless. Get them. Eat them, enjoy them. See the varieties of people. Tall people, skinny people, lighter skinned people, darker skinned people, people with curly hair, people with straight hair. Allah says, look at my varieties that I created. Aren't they all beautiful? Are they not? فَتَبَارَكَ اللَّهُ أَحْسَنَ الْخَالِقِينَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created such magnificent. أَلَّذِي أَحْسَنَ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ خَلَقَ. Allah says, indeed, everything He creates is beautiful. See around, even creatures, four-legged creatures that you and I may be repulsed by seeing their, you know, like a, if you see a dog of a certain kind and he's drooling, says, oh, that's an ugly thing. Don't say that's ugly. That's a magnificent creation. That if you and I were given the opportunity to create something like that, we would not be able to do it. We would not be able to make one fur of that dog. For the quality that Allah has made cannot be challenged, even in today, with the ability that we produce man-made substances that try to mimic the natural laws. They're very difficult to follow the natural law because there are so many forces that bring about what we have. Allah says, acknowledge it, enjoy it. But at the same time, make sure that you're constantly sifting the trash and keeping the good. This is Islam in its purest form. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. So while we struggle, very important brothers and sisters, especially living in the Western part of the world where we are surrounded by various cultures. We find Islamic centers, not here, I'm not pointing this one, I'm just generalizing it, where one center doesn't get along with another center. Oh, this one is from that culture, I'm from this culture. It's okay, that difference is good. Oh, but we talk this language, they talk that language. They do their azah for Imam Hussein differently. No problem. Why not? I remember when I first saw the Afghan community doing their azah, one man would hold a stick and he would walk back and forth in a peripatetic fashion and he'd be reciting the khutbah of Imam Hussein and everybody would be sitting, hitting their laps, and crying. I said, wow, that's an interesting expression of grief. It's beautiful. What's wrong with it? Then there are other groups who go in circles as they cry for Imam Hussein. And there are others who turn the lights off as they look up and they cry to Allah that there was injustice done and we are bearing witness that this injustice was done. But these formulations are fine. Now, should we use them as means to divide ourselves? No. We're living in a society today where the fundamental principle in Islam is unity. If you and I ever want to prove our witness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we, oh Allah, we truly believe in you, then we have to proactively work towards unity, not only within Islam, which is the most important, but within humanity. That we must be susceptible to different religions and look at them with respect and honor them and welcome them and have discussions while we agree to disagree agreeably. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. So Allah in the Quran in Surah Ar-Rahman says, وَأَقِيمُ الْوَزْنَ بِالْقِسْطِ. Maintain the balance. وَلَا تُخْسِرُ الْمِيزَانِ. And do not violate the mizan. And it is an obligation upon us that we must maintain it very carefully. But to do this requires constant cogitation, constant reflection, thinking. I've had many an opportunity here every night where people come and ask me, brother, with regards to this issue, what is your position? You mentioned this, so this means this. This is a conversation, it's healthy. I don't have the answers to all these questions. We all struggle to know from each other and we learn from each other. But that sharing and caring is what makes life so beautiful. This is what makes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala happy with a human being who is actively pursuing understanding of what their purpose in life is. And there's a rawayat of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam who stated, salawat ala Muhammad wa Muhammad. Who stated, and the riwayat, in other words, where the Holy Prophet has stated many, many riwayat on this issue with regards to the reflection of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to bring about constant cogitation that insan should be reflecting, sitting together, discussing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and keeping the focus of life within prescriptions. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran, in terms of balance, of seeing people of other religions and sitting with them and checking whether or not my faith is the same as your faith and looking at whether your belief in God is the same as my belief in God. For example, I lost my thought of this riwayat, forgive me, because my mind is moving in 12 directions right now, forgive me. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Inshallah it'll come back. In the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes people who are His representatives on earth. What qualities are these people? What is their nature? For example, you find in Surah Al-Furqan, وَعِبَادُ الرَّحْمَنِ الَّذِينَ يَمْشُونَ الْأَرْضِ هَوْنًا وَإِذَا خَاتَبَهُمُ الْجَاهِلُونَ قَالُوا سَلَامًا. This is a description of a human being who is reflecting about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, about the purpose of life, and carefully monitoring what is my obligation. This is a transaction now, because at the end of the day, when you and I practice Islam, it is the most powerful thing you and I can do. The most powerful thing. Practice. You know, something comes in my mind. Yesterday, a brother was telling me something very interesting. That there was a man who was an atheist who went to see Al-Quds Day. No, a Christian went to visit Al-Quds Day. You know, Al-Quds Day, which happens the last Friday of Ramadan. And he noticed there were two sides. One was pro-occupation, one was anti-occupation. And his observation that he noticed was that the ones who were against the occupation, the ones who were for the Quds Day, the Muslims, were so gentle, were so loving, were so caring, while they were standing behind with their placards. He was so impressed by it that 2 days later he did his shahada. 2 days later he did his shahada. A brother was just telling me yesterday, Salawat ala Muhammad wa Muhammad. Look, no conversations, no arguments, no debates, just vision of akhlaq, khulq, when a person knows how to behave, knows how to control his tongue, being able to refrain from cursing, for example, from using foul language, being able to contain that requires practice, requires an understanding, and people observe that. I know in all my clients that I've ever had in my businesses, one thing clients have always told me, they said, we've noticed you don't use foul words. We don't see you using those four-letter words. I said, it's vulgar to me. It's foul. And as much as we want to express it in our anger, it demeans us. It belittles us. And I've noticed, subhanAllah, that as much as they use foul language, when I'm in their presence, they don't use it. While I do business with them, they don't use it. They're very careful and cognizant. And it puts a smile on my face, knowing that while I am present, I have prevented a few less foul words during the day. Now think about what we call damage control. That if I could, and you, imagine if we amplify, and I'm not saying it's me, all of us, that when we have that character and we carry it and people understand it and they respect us for it and they recognize us for it, imagine how many damages we are preventing. Just like those, that group gets together and they're doing some bad talk. And then a God-fearing person comes in their presence and they're all silent. You've seen that all the time. They're silent. They stop talking. They want this guy to leave so they can start their troubles again. But while the person is there, subhanAllah, isn't that wonderful? That individual temporarily was able to silence them in a positive way. That is the beauty of life. The balancing power of akhlaq, where an individual is recognized to be a spiritual individual, not being extreme, but firm in principle, that even when weddings are taking place and haram things are going to take place, they will not invite such an individual. Because they know if they were to invite such an individual, they have to make choices either to shut that foolish music off and all the satanic ways that people celebrate, or leave this guy out and let us have our merrymaking. It's good. It's a good relationship at that level. That if people can be recognized under these conditions, that don't invite that person because he will not come because there's music in the gathering. Alhamdulillah. That at least that person has stood firm that on Judgment Day, he can be a witness to Allah. They did not invite me. And Alhamdulillah, they didn't invite me. But at least they knew that the reason they didn't invite me was because I'm a principled individual. Isn't that a good thing? Now we might say, oh, but I missed out an invitation. You think the whole world is revolving around one invitation, around one wedding, around one marriage? You think this world of 7 billion people, vast earth, that if you took the entire population of earth, you can place them within the state of California, just in Los Angeles. You think this world is small? 7 billion people is 7,000 million people. You know how many possible transactions you and I can have, and we're worried about one wedding? Think about that. It's kind of childish and silly for us to think, oh, if I don't get invited, oh, then let me give up my principles. What about the Day of Judgment when all the billions will be standing? Allah says, يَوْمَ لَا يَنْفَعُ مَالٌ وَلَا بَنُونَ يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ. Look, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is warning us. يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ اتَّقُوا رَبَّكُمْ وَخْشَوْ يَوْمًا لَا يَجْزِي وَالِدٌ عَنْ وَلَدِي وَلَا مَوْلُودٌ هُوَ جَازٍ عَنْ وَالِدِهِ شَيْئًا إِنَّ وَعْدَ اللَّهِ حَقٌّ فَلَا تَغُرَّنَّكُمُ الْحَيَاةُ الدُّنْيَا وَلَا يَغُرَّنَّكُمْ بِاللَّهِ الْغُرُورِ. Look at how Allah in Surah Luqman, the last few verses, says, O mankind, be cognizant of that day. يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ اتَّقُوا رَبَّكُمْ وَخْشَوْا يَوْمًا لَا يَجْزِي وَالِدٌ عَنْ وَلَدِي. No father nor son will help each other. وَلَا مَوْلُودٌ هُوَ جَازٍ عَنْ وَالِدِهِ شَيْئًا. شَيْئًا, meaning not even a little. The father sitting next to his son says, son, on that day, I won't know you, you won't know me. شَيْئًا. Allah said, فَلَا تَغُرَّنَّكُمُ الْحَيَاةُ الدُّنْيَا. And don't let the glitter of this world beguile you and fool you. وَلَا يَغُرَّنَّكُمْ بِاللَّهِ الْغَرُورُ. And don't let shaitan fool you. Many a times people sent texts to me even after these lectures. Brother, you just said this very important issue. The youth are still out there commingling, intermingling, smoking, doing their satanic things. After these nights of Ashura, they're still doing it. Oh, brother, it's not reaching their ears. I said, no. It will reach their ears. We must never lose hope. That as much as you and I may say, oh, our community is lost, our young generations are becoming drug addicts, we must consistently stand firm, just like our blessed imams did, that as much as there was tyranny in their regions, they never stopped speaking. Imam Ali alayhi salam never stopped getting on the pulpit and revealing it to people, while people would interject and bother him in the middle. I was just reading a khutbah today where Imam Ali alayhi salam is reminding them of how good the Ansars were when the Prophet went to Medina. And a man says, stands up, a tall man, he says, we are neither Ansars, nor are you the Prophet. Look at how he would answer him. Imam says, sit down, for I was not saying that I am the Prophet. Did I ever say I am the Prophet? I am reminding you of the Prophet and what the Prophet was done to and how the people dealt with him. But look how people had to deal with him, that while he's giving them exhortation, they are preventing him from speaking. This is the world we live in today. Then it was like this. It's different now? No. I made that choice as a teenager too, that I could be one of these. The ones recalcitrant individuals who constantly challenge the institutions and have two faces and two lives. I asked that question to myself. Can I stand in front of Allah with two faces? And I'm not claiming to be something pure with one face. We're all struggling. We're all struggling with our two dimensions of lives that we live in, the dark side and the good side. We all are struggling. And Allah says, it's okay. قُلْ يَا عِبَادِيَ الَّذِينَ أَصْرَفُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ لَا تَقْنَطُوا مِنْ رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ. Keep struggling. Remind yourself. Every once in a while, listen to the majlis. Every once in a while, open the Quran. Every morning, open the Quran. Read it. It will strike your heart. It will change you. I've seen teenagers who've had girlfriends deeply rooted in affairs where they walk up and they say, this is wrong. This is haram. They go to clubs and they drink and they do all haram things. They gamble. They said, haram. This is haram. I know this is destruction. My life has nothing but darkness. How do I get out? They make a concerted move and they get out and they hold on to people who believe in Allah and they've come out and they're shining like stars today. Well, how did that happen? You must never lose hope. Never. But it is a world of contradictions. It is a world of misunderstandings. And these discussions, inshallah, hopefully will shed more light to this broad, spectacular universe Allah has created us in and given us an opportunity, a very short opportunity, to stand upright and to be good and to do our best to avoid that which is haram. Because brothers, especially my young brothers and sisters, I say to you, believe me, Allah is my witness. You are young today, you will blink, you will be old tomorrow. Guaranteed, as I mentioned yesterday, the 90-year-old man, 30 years of his personal life, you ask a person, how old is a 30-year-old person? You say, he's a young man. He's just beginning to bloom. Well, that's when Allah takes your soul away. So how quickly have we lived on this earth? So don't be fooled into thinking, no, go and have your fun. Express yourselves. Look at Canadian societies and American society. Everybody's free out there dating and having a good time. Don't fool yourself. Many a times I say, why are our children so active in their pursuits for the opposite gender? It's biological. You can't avoid it. It happened even in the Prophet's time. Humans cannot avoid having that passion because it's inbuilt. So then we ask, okay, God, you put this biology in me, so now you want me to prevent it? I mean, isn't that a contradiction? Here, one minute you want me to be abstinent. You want me to be, decent. You want me to be aware of my haya, so that I should not indulge in affairs, premarital or postmarital. But then my biology is taking me all over the place. My fantasy world is taking me all the place. True. A wise individual takes that and says, why is that the case? What's driving me there? It's like a person who's allergic to something. A doctor will say, let me see what your susceptibility is. Maybe there's a chemical in this food that's causing you to have rashes. What would you do? You'd continue to have rashes? Or you'd try to avoid that chemical? Well, the same thing with my character, that if something ignites my mind and takes me in the haram way, then wisdom dictates, try your best to avoid that circle. Try your best to be among circles that will not remind you there. Move away from that danger. Otherwise, it will put you into bigger trouble. Isn't that not a logical answer? But look, in societies today, you cannot turn the television on, as I mentioned, without violence and sex.
You cannot walk outside without some woman showing herself and some man showing himself. You cannot go online and have a chat without some innuendo. You cannot open up email without some click here to have a good time business. Can you avoid this? Very difficult. It's a matter of split seconds and shaitan is waiting for you. 1,000 times. Look at the billboards. Without having some scanty dressed woman, you can't even sell a car. Right? What does a car have to do with a woman? It doesn't matter. It ignites your mind into fantasies that yes, if I have that car, I'll have that kind of a woman. Fantasy land. And the minute you start promoting this fantasy, you can't stop. You start dressing that way, you start talking that way. And of course, what better instrument than the music that is formulated by the industries today to try to entice you even more. These things have to be carefully monitored. Now we cannot say, okay, we're going to throw our hands up in the air as Muslims. How are we going to live? We're going to be squeaky clean. We're going to sanitize ourselves. We can't. Everywhere you go, there's music. Everywhere you go, there are these pictures. What do you do? So Allah says, seek some protection. Salah, for example. Inna salata tanha anil fahshai wal munkar. Prayer keeps you away from wrongdoing and evil. We think, oh, it's something up and down as an exercise. Believe me, if you and I spend a few seconds thinking about how important that salah is, it really, really checks us. That first, you cannot even approach it without being pure and clean. You cannot be in a state of pollution. Wow, that's a job in itself. So Allah says now, if you have a choice, you want to be in pollution so you cannot pray, or do you want to keep away from pollution so you can pray? Well, that's a choice you and I have to make. That concerted choice we make delineates the difference between who you are and who you're not. In my life, I remember I never knew the value of salah until my American friend said, you know, we trust you so much because you pray. We like you because you pray. We honor you because you pray. They're not Muslims. I was shocked. I said, are you saying this to please me? They said, no. When you pray, we feel good. You look like you are a God-conscious person. We know we can trust you. There's something natural in us that even a hypocrite tries to hide under that. Even then, that's why Allah warns us, فَوَيْلٌ لِلْمُصَلِّينَ الَّذِينَ عَنْ صَلَاتِهِمْ سَاهُونَ. Woe to the prayerful ones. But why is he prayerful? Because he's hiding in the garb. For that garb works. For when someone puts on the garb of salah, and when they pray, there's something natural in their ethos that makes us comfortable about this individual to say, wow, this is a prayerful one. That's a God-conscious individual. And a God-conscious individual means he's conscious of his morals and he knows there's an oversight of someone watching him and he's afraid of that day when God will hold them liable. Isn't that a good thing? Today we have societies that say, what's prayer? Friends go outside, what prayer? Forget prayer. Give up prayer. And we find children becoming atheists and agnostics. Many parents come to me and say, my child has become an atheist, or my child has become a Salafi, extremist. What do I do? How do I stop them? And I look at them and I say, it's a very valid question. If I was in your shoes, I'd be very worried. How do you stop them? He says, yeah, give me some pointers so I can tell my son or my daughter. I says, you know, I'd love to give you 1,000 pointers. But my first question is, how convinced are you? She says, well, me, you know, and my father told me everything, you know. He told me, Allah is there, Allah is there. Do your prayer. I did my prayer. And did you ask him why? She says, well, what for? Father's always right, right? I said, welcome to the real world. It doesn't work that way anymore. You're not going to tell your child, you're going to pray. Father, son will say, okay, dad, there are very few children like this in the world today, where there's a friend out there saying, hey, what's wrong with you? You're such a chicken, you're following your father. Come on, you need to challenge him. Do you know that's an old man? He's of the old world. We're the new world. And the son comes home and starts being belligerent with the parents and starts arguing with them to prove to his friends, see how tough I am, look how cool I am. So I can challenge. I'm good in challenging. So I ask the father, how convinced are you? He says, well, I haven't spent much time. You know, I'm old now, ready to go. I said, don't say that. You're not old. I don't care if you're 2,000 years old. You're not old. He said, well, what do you mean? I said, when Malakul Maut comes, every second will be like eternity. That you will wish you could utter La ilaha illallah before your soul leaves. How about that? Don't ever say, I am old. Don't ever say, I cannot start learning. Don't ever say that, let me indulge in this conversation with my son. That let me, maybe I should also learn and find out the truth that while my son sees me struggling with the haqq, that my son will understand that my father has put himself under that. Maybe now I am convinced that where the truth lies is the truth and not those whimsical talks that people give out there in academia that there is no God. Do we? No.
Why should I? I'm Muslim. Jannah is wajib on me. I gotta go to paradise. I mean, I'm a Muslim. I say la ilaha illallah. I do tasbih every day. I must enter paradise. So if we're convinced with that, the child says, Dad, you go. I'll go my separate ways. I have my ways of going there too. Now imagine that contradiction. There's no cogitative reflection in the family. When we are so worldly and contradictory in our transactions, how do we expect the world and our children especially to see us as role models? Tell me. How does a child, I've seen some children, I sit with them. I had a boy at the camp. I was stunned by him. He came from Switzerland. 12-year-old boy. Asking me the deepest questions about the destiny of God's creation. And about predestination and justice. And I'm looking and says, SubhanAllah, how old are you? He says, I'm 12. I said, wow, such deep thinking? He said, yes, because I reflect all the time. I talk about this. People are stunned by a 12-year-old asking such questions because in modern times, who's got time for a 12-year-old to be asking such questions? But that's the problem. Every 12-year-old can ask those kind of questions. The problem is the environment is not there. The friends are just not there. The shows on televisions are just not there to excite such conversations. Today, it's a godless society. Don't talk about God and politics. Two things, you'll never come to a conclusion, they tell you. Don't get involved in it. Just avoid it. So now there's no spirit in the heart because Allah is not spoken about. Prayer is being avoided. What does it feed with then? That when we are dissatisfied, we become material in our satisfaction. We indulge in alcohol. We indulge in drugs. And today, smoking this weed, for example, has become so prevalent because it's becoming legalized. We're finding all kinds of intoxications taking place in our children's lifestyles because parents are shrugging their shoulders and saying, well, what can we do? This is the society. Whereas if we indulge them in proactive thinking and preemptive measures to say, yes, it's there. You can grab that cocaine. Yes, you can snort it if you want. But here are the consequences. This is what's going to happen. Look at the ones who are doing it. This is the consequence of one who dates and dates frequently, that he cannot keep his marriage. This is the one who's doing postmarital affairs. You know why? Look at his past. You want to be there? If you want to be there, it's a free world. Go. When the child realizes that it's my destiny that I'm going to choose, and when they are made aware of these dangers, you will find, subhanAllah, they avoid it. And then the girls start tapping on the shoulder. What's wrong with you? How come you're not looking at me? Don't you like my dress? The boy says, well, whatever it is, I don't want to look at you. What's wrong with you? You're being too extreme. You don't express yourself. Or the girl, not wearing, she wants to wear a hijab. We say, what's wrong with you? Who's going to marry you? You wear a hijab, no one's going to see how beautiful you are. Take it off. Husbands today feel proud to parade their wives in business transactions. That's my beautiful Barbie doll that I inherited. Right here. Look, but don't touch. Yeah? It's like putting an explosive next to him and you pull the pin. It says, don't let this explode, okay? What are you talking about? Such foolish mentality that yes, even women, you find them, why aren't you wearing? Well, my husband doesn't allow me to because if I do, I'm going to get divorced because, you know, I'm that incredible catch that he got. I see that all the time. I have discussions with this. Or vice versa, where a woman says, I don't have to wear hijab. There's no ayah in the Quran about hijab. We'll talk about hijab, inshallah. And the principles, even outside of the Quran, from social principles, you will understand that why is the hijab such an attacked institution in the world today? You think the French have nothing better to do? You think the Turks have nothing better to do? Why is it being so attacked all over the world? Because it is the flag of Islam. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. The Quran continues. Balance. But balance means knowing extremities. What is extreme? When a child sees that my father, an uncle or brother is balanced, they make balanced choices. How? By questioning everything. Like Quran says, قُلْ هَاتُوا بُرْهَانَكُمْ إِن كُنْتُمْ صَادِقِينَ. You talk about God? I want to know who's this God. I want to balance it. When I used to attend Bible study, people said, you're going to become a Christian? I said, no, I'm looking for the balancing point. I want to know, can God have a son? Is it possible? If it's possible, then I must entertain it. And the more I read the Bible, the more I used to go to Bible study, I said, where does Jesus say, worship me, I'm God? He never says that. He says, why callest thou me good? There is none good but that which sent me. Why do you call me good? There is no good but one. SubhanAllah. When I would pose this, I said, why is Jesus saying this? Why is he not admitting that he is God? Where does he say, worship me? That even when Lazarus died, he's praying.
He's praying to who? He says, oh God, please, let not this cup pass. Oh, bring Lazarus back. I said, I thought he's God. Who is he praying to? These questions were so simple, but what did it do for me? It gave me a position. That, when it comes to religion, I see where the issues are. Now what happens is this very simple. And believe me, we don't have to be geniuses to understand this. It's a very simple matter. Don't be caught, please. You know, last night I was watching television. And I was stunned by this guy who calls himself Prophet something, something, I don't know. It's a black guy. Calls himself a prophet. He's sitting there, make sure you sign up for my, you know, cubicle. Give me some dollars, you know, and I'll save you. I said, I can't believe there are actually people who entertain this guy. Insan, is that foolish? لكن أكثر الناس لا يعقلون. He's wearing a nice suit, and a woman comes and says, yeah, touch the Lord, and he pushes her. Ah, you're saved, hallelujah. And she falls and says, ah. Like, I said, you actually believe that? She says, where's your faith? Faith? What faith? The guy's got a Rolls Royce, he's got a jet, and he's saving me by pushing me? What religion is this? But it's come down to that. In Michigan, there's a book being sent out to all the Muslims. 10 amazing Muslims. Look, with a picture of 10 Muslims. How they were Muslims, they all became Christian. And they managed to get our addresses. You know, it's very hard to, when you know this, like, for example, within the Khoja community, you have your addresses, somebody mails to all of you. He must have gotten something. They're very active. And I commend them for their activity. At least they're making some effort. I like that. Even when Jehovah's Witnesses come to my door, I say, thank you for coming. You took the time and the trouble to come to me. Thank you. I appreciate that. You didn't leave me in the dark according to your minds. But come in, we'll have coffee, and we'll share. Right? And in that book, what do they say? This Muslim walking around, he was so lost, had no idea about God. Then he went to university, and there was this person with a short arm. And this evangelical guy just touched it and became long. So I was convinced, that's it, I've become a Christian. And now he's preaching the gospel. I said, I can't believe you actually wrote this and you're sending it to us. You think we're so elementary in our thinking? Even elementary doesn't answer this. How? What do you mean? Oh, he touched my arm and became long. Subhanallah, what a miracle. And then the atheist on the other side is laughing. You see, that's why religion is so bad. You see this? Look at this. Got false prophets claiming to be driving Rolls Royces, jets. That's why religion is. So there's this mush on one side of utter ignorance, on the other side of utter rejection. And then this Muslim poor child or non-Muslim child lost between these two extremities, trying to figure out, where's my balancing point? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, read the Quran. The balancing point of the Quran in which it guides you about belief in Allah, about belief in the day of judgment, belief in prophets. Who are prophets? Why are they so sublime? Why is the Quran giving you prescriptions? Believe me, there is no book on earth the way the sublime quality of a human being can be reached other than the Quran. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. So what does Allah say? What does Allah say here? And the servants of the beneficent are the ones who walk on earth in humbleness. And when the ignorant address them, they say peace. Why? They take the burdens away. Peace. Qalu salama. They don't interject. Why? Because it's like walking on muddy pathways and you have pebbles and you're wearing a nice shirt or a nice dress. Don't throw pebbles on muddy pathways. It will splatter. So when you have an ignorant person, you must recognize that, back off. But now to know an ignorant person requires reflection. So notice, struggle, 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 struggle. This is the power of Islam. Keep struggling, because struggling strengthens you. Ask any person who goes to the gym and works out. Ask him, aren't you tired? He said, yes, I'm tired, but I have a way in which I make sure that I have maximum strength to work out. By the way, working out is extremely important for us. The ultimate living machine, in my opinion, is the human body. And Allah has designed it elegantly and magnificently. And we must maximize its longevity. It's a haq upon us, Our skin and our body will complain on Judgment Day. If we abuse it and put poisons into it, the body will complain to Allah on Judgment Day. We are living in the society today where gymnasiums are available here in this wonderful Jaafari Center. You have a magnificent gymnasium downstairs. Magnificent. I've seen in Africa people carrying rocks, lifting rocks, trying to get weights just to get some resistance. I see them running on the beach trying to get some cardio. We have some fantastic equipment. Our community of 5,000, 10,000 community members here, these institutions should be filled. Our next generations, even our older generations, should get into a routine of lifting weights and at least doing cardio exercises, because they've done studies that when you do resistance, your bone density increases. And when your muscle mass increases, even your metabolism increases and your healthiness is increased. People have shown that when you go and work out, you remove the toxins, you remove the anxiety, and your diet changes. You become abstemious in your food. You start eating good food, healthy food, organic food. You might think, what is this? Islam is encouraging this, that our teeth should shine and our hair should shine and our faces should glow. This is not other than Islam. This is Islam. Islam is not to be wretched and old and look broken. When Imam Ali alayhi salam is talking about his Shia who are broken, it's because they were fighting against the enemies all the time. We're in a world today, we have these luxuries. We have equipment like these. We should utilize them and build upon them and make sure our children and ourselves are healthy. But here's an important footnote, that don't let that glow of the face take us in the wrong direction. See, that's the contradiction in life. That the minute you start looking really good, the attractions turn on. So it's a fine line, please. That as much as a young person looks very good, it's got very good physical state, very strong, watch out. People will always look at you. And if you don't use it, fi sabilillah, it'll take you in the haram. That's why they say the most beautiful people are the most oppressed on this earth. Because they have so many opportunities, it's very hard to avoid. And if they avoid, they get cornered like Yusuf alayhi salam. It's the world. But still, please, please achieve it. Keep healthy food, and utilize these facilities. I know living in Michigan, we're always looking for gymnasiums and gyms. Why? Because working out is extremely important. Believe me, I cannot stress enough. Just like brushing our teeth and flossing. Flossing is one of the most important things we can do to maintain. Even the Messenger of Allah says, if I could put an injunction upon my believers to do miswak 3 times a day, I would have made it obligatory. The Holy Prophet stated that. How important it is to keep your teeth clean. How important it is to keep your face clean. Look at the rahmah of Allah. You talk about ecology, you talk about sociology, you talk about biology. Islam has got all the prescriptions on what to eat, how much to eat. Even Imam Radha alayhi salatu wasalam answers the question to the diet. The Quran says, "Kulu washrabu wa la tusrifu. Innahu la yuhibbul musrifin." Look at the answer to the balance. The whole multi-trillion dollar diet problem is in the Quran in one sentence. كُلُوا وَشْرَبُوا وَلَا تُسْرِفُوا إِنَّهُ لَا يُحِبُّ الْمُسْرِفِينَ That's it. Yo, eat this, don't eat this, don't eat this, don't eat that, don't eat. Okay, this is good. But at the end of the day, it's not that. Eat good food, halal food, but eat in moderation. That's it. Imam Radha alayhi salam was asked, how much should I eat? He says, that first plate, when you're done, you want to go for the second, push it away. You're done. And there's a trigger in the mind that sends a trigger to the stomach. That if you eat too fast, you'll eat too much. If you eat slow, you'll eat less. Because the trigger in the stomach will be told, there's food coming, slow down. So you find if you just naturally have a natural diet, you will never gain weight. Now, gaining weight has many issues because it brings about type 2 diabetes. It brings about all kinds of medical complications in life. Why should we not utilize preemptive measures to protect ourselves? As they say, prevention is much better than cure, isn't it? Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. No matter how old we are, brothers and sisters, seriously, our sisters and our brothers, find places where they can exercise in a halal way, but do it. You'll be surprised that when the body starts to take shape, the thinking gets sharper, the longevity gets better, the burden on the family gets less. All these combinations are rahmah of Allah. These are the balances. So here Allah says, they're the ones who walk on the earth in humbleness, and when the ignorant address them, they say peace. وَالَّذِينَ يَبِيتُونَ لِرَبِّهِمْ سُجَّدًا وَقِيَامًا. See, that's the spiritual component now. The spiritual component is here, that they say they walk with humbleness and who pass the night prostrating themselves before the Lord and standing. Now, what is prostrating and standing? Doing Salatul Layl all night? No, could even be 5 minutes. You get out of your bed, you hold turba or face towards the Qibla, pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, thank Him. Go to sleep, do just wudu, very simple. Okay, don't do wudu if you don't think it's time. If you don't think we'd have the energy, read Surah Al-Ikhlas before you go to sleep. I bear witness there is no God but you, and Muhammad is the messenger, and there is no one equal to you. And read Surah Al-Ikhlas, قُلْ وَاللَّهُ أَحَدُ اللَّهُ السَّمَدُ. Read that surah and go to sleep. Ibadah, that's ibadah. That when you wake up, like Imam Ali alayhi salam used to wake up, every time he would wake up, the first thing when he opens up, he says, لَا حَوْلَ وَلَا قُوَّةَ إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ. There is no authority but you, O God. Thank you for giving me one more day to serve you. And he would put his right foot on the ground, and then he would walk. Why? That I am going to do everything right for you, O Allah. That starting point every morning, believe me, has a very powerful connotation. That entire day there will be a reminder that you made a promise today that you're going to start your day with honesty, integrity, truthfulness. This is what deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Let's continue briefly and I will end with this. وَالَّذِينَ يَقُولُونَ رَبَّنَا اصْرِفْ عَنَّ عَذَابَ جَهَنَّمْ إِنَّ عَذَابَ كَانَ غَرَامًا. They're cognizant, not afraid of hell, cognizant that their foolish misbehavior, their tilting this scale of misbehavior can lead them to hell. So they say, our Lord, turn away from us the punishment of hell. How does Allah turn away punishment of hell? Punishment of hell is turned away from us by making us aware of it, by making us cognizant of it, and by making us realize that it is in our hands that we're going to send ourselves to hell. Allah did not create us for hell, brothers and sisters. Allah created us for paradise. So you might be asking, well, if that's the case, then why did He create hell? He created hell because this is a world of trials. In the world of trials, we're in a potential to enter paradise, which you and I never deserve. That when we enter paradise, inshallah we will. When we enter paradise, we will recognize that no matter how good we were on this earth, we don't deserve this. That's why we say Alhamdulillah. In the Quran, Allah says when they enter paradise, they'll say Alhamdulillah alladhi hadana lihada wa ma kunna linahtadiya lawla an hadana Allah. Thank you, Allah, for guiding me to this. For had you not, I wouldn't have gotten it. That means entry into paradise is by Allah's mercy. And we know that as much as we may have struggled on this earth and died even on a battlefield becoming shuhada, it does not qualify us to enter paradise in the scope of the enormous mercy of Allah. But Allah is so merciful, He says you deserve it. So we know that. Now, in the scope of this trial of worlds, if hell was not present, then my free will would have to leave. For one of the greatest gifts Allah has given me is the power of free will. And therefore, my free will would be tantamount to me recognizing hell and its avoidance therefore. Look, even in the sports industry, you will find that there are lines that demarcate good and evil. As long as the ball is inside the line, it's good, continues to play. If it crosses that line, depending on basketball, for example, if you touch the line, you're out. Correct? In tennis, it has to be on the outside of the line. Okay, it's still a demarcating point. That means a good tennis player knows how to avoid that and knows how to make the opponent put it there. That's what it's all about. A golfer knows that you have to avoid the bunkers. Don't get your ball in there. Don't get it into the woods because you will lose points that way. You must avoid it. So now do we ask all these sports people who are creating all these sports that we should get rid of these evils? Should we get rid of the bunkers? Should we get rid of the lines? So that then there is no demarcation and everything becomes good? People say, what kind of silly idea is this? Then where is the trial? Where is the value of the sport? What we honor, we pay 7 figures to these people, is their power to avoid by understanding that line of demarcation. So what's the difference between that on a higher scale at the moral level than for us to understand where Jahannam lies, where hell lies, where the wrong lies? If we don't know it, how will we know what to avoid? How will we know that my moral prescriptions has to be guided and that I must avoid being indulgent and killing people like these genocidal killers who are killing in the world today? Do you think they understand it? They don't care. Quran even states it, that the ones who commit these heinous crimes are the ones who don't believe in the Day of Judgment. Day of Judgment is so important. And belief in heaven and hell is so important that Imam Hussein alayhi salam, when he starts his mission, and I recited that a few nights ago, where he gives it to his brother Muhammad ibn Hanafiya, he gives him that will. He says in it, I believe, I bear witness that is a heaven and a hell. I bear witness that the judgment day is coming. I bear witness with it. And we'll talk about the prevalence of the Day of Judgment. Logically and rationally, you will see that the best way to live on this earth is with the understanding of the Day of Judgment. You will see, and we will discuss it. Without, you don't need physical evidence. It's what we call deductive evidence. Very powerful, and you will see it. Belief in hell. So even the Quran states that when they are being thrown, these disbelievers like Muawiyah and Yazid and Ibn Sa'd, and this, by the way, I believe, this verse that comes in Surah Al-Mulk, you will see that it's an exact quotation of people like Muawiyah. Muawiyah used to say, this brother of Hashim claims there's a Day of Judgment. It doesn't exist. He claims to have received revelations. He hasn't received any revelations. His father was the same, Abu Sufyan. Abu Sufyan even kicked the grave of Hamza. He says, your fathers fought in the battle with my fathers. Today that religion is in my hand. Abu Sufyan said this. In the Quran, the angels are asking these same people who are being flung in hell, people like Yazid and Muawiyah, أَلَمْ يَأْتِكُمْ نَذِيرٌ Didn't a warner come to you? قَالُوا بَلَىٰ قَدْ جَاءَنَا نَذِيرٌ فَكَذَّبْنَا وَقُلْنَا مَا نَزَّلَ اللَّهُ مِنْ شَيْءٍ إِنْ أَنْتُمْ إِلَّا فِي ضَلَالٍ كَبِيرٍ وَقَالُوا لَوْ كُنَّا نَسْمَعُ أَوْ نَعْقِلُ مَا كُنَّ فِي أَصْحَابِ السَّعِيرِ فَعَتَرَفُوا بِذَنْبِهِمْ فَسُحْكًا لِأَصْحَابِ السَّعِيرِ إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَخْشَوْنَ رَبَّهُمْ بِالْغَيْبِ لَهُمْ مَغْفِرَةٌ وَأَجْرٌ كَبِيرٌ Look at how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala exemplifies in this surah. He says, and when they are being, before they're being flung, they see hell roaring. The hell is roaring. They hear it. And they're terrified. Angels look at them and say, didn't a warner come to you? How did you become this person who's been going to be flung in hell now? أَلَمْ يَأْتِكُمْ نَذِيرٌ قَالُوا بَلَىٰ They will say, nay. When they came, we belied them. We called them liars. And then they will admit, لَوْ كُنَّا نَسْمَعُ أَوْ نَعْقِلُ If only we listened and paid attention, مَا كُنَّا فِي أَصْحَابِ We would not be the inmates of this hell. Allah says they will recognize their dhamb. فَعَتَرَبْفُوا بِذَنْبِهِمْ And Allah is furthest away from them. Allah says, indeed, the one who remembers Allah in the dark, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَخْشَوْنَ رَبَّهُمْ بِالْغَيْبِ Because we're not showing off anymore. We are afraid of our Lord, not in a negative fear, but knowing how great, how graceful, how merciful He has been upon us, and then for us to reject Him, that fear is something that we must all the time think about. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Now, I'll just finally I'll conclude. وَالَّذِينَ لَا يَدْعُونَ مَعَ اللَّهِ إِلَهًا آخَرَ وَلَا يَقْتُلُونَ النَّفْسَ الَّتِي حَرَّمَ اللَّهُ إِلَّا بِالْحَقِّ وَلَا يَزْنُونَ وَمَنْ يَفْعَلْ ذَلِكَ يَلْقَ أَثَامًا Meaning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying they don't call on anyone other than Allah. God is their object and their transactions are fully balanced. Then Allah says, وَالَّذِينَ لَا يَشْهَدُونَ الزُّورَ وَإِذَا مَرُّوا بِاللَّغْوِ مَرُّوا كِرَامًا They don't bear witness to what is false, and when they pass by what is vain, they pass by it nobly. Quran even says, when it comes to their spending, they're neither stingy nor extravagant, but in between. Meaning, even in spending, the Quran is talking about balance. Balance. Understand your extremities, become balanced. Understand your reality, become balanced. Understand how the universe works, get into the middle. Balance it. Understand that there are extremities, do not follow the extremities. And then this surah ends, inshallah, that very beautiful dua. He says, وَالَّذِينَ يَقُولُونَ This is long, I have just jumped on it. But they say, look, the Quran is describing how you and I should be. That's why it's so important to read it. وَالَّذِينَ يَقُولُونَ رَبَّنَا هَبْ لَنَا مِنْ أَزْوَاجِنَا وَذُرِّيَّاتِنَا قُرَّةَ أَعْيُنٍ وَجْعَلْنَا لِلْمُتَّقِينَ إِمَامًا. Look how beautiful this verse is. They are the ones who say, our Lord, grant us in our mates, our spouses, and our offspring, the joy of our eyes. Look how pragmatic Islam is. That when I'm talking about marriage, when I'm talking about having a wife, or for a woman having a husband, a mate, nothing is more important than happiness. People go out and do all kinds of haram things because they're not happy. Because they're not satisfied. I've seen husbands have beautiful wives who serve them very well, but they're not happy. And the reverse. Excellent husbands and the wives are not happy. Why are they not happy? Because they think there's something better out there. Because they've been fooled, not living for the cause of Allah, that they think the opportunities are so plenty. Let me go out there and experiment. And sadly, I see this real tragic event happens when men get older and they go through what they call a midlife crisis and they decide to marry a younger woman only to leave their older wives. Older wife, which in my opinion is a breach of contract. It's a breach that you've taken a person's life and joined it with yours. How can you do that? Oh, we were just waiting for the kids to grow old, then we could go our separate ways. Okay, did you not fix it during the time? Oh, it's irreconcilable. Okay, maybe it's irreconcilable. But there are issues where men find themselves trying to live at a younger age now and they give up their wives. Tell me, in the eyes of Allah, is this haqq? Is this justice? You might say, but what about my pleasures? Allah says, curtail it. Your pleasure is not for this world. That if you cannot find beauty in that woman that you married all these years, then why were you there? What were you doing? You think it's easy to get into a business with someone and keep playing with that business and then decide to walk away when you want to walk away? I don't think so. This is the injustice that happened in our societies today. That when these separations take place, children suffer. Okay, if there's a valid reason, then children understand. Otherwise, we put pain and grief on them. Do we want that in this world? Or do we want to die with peace and tranquility? Having, even if our children have left this world, even if our wives have been killed, at least we die peacefully. That, oh Allah, while I had it in my hand, I was just with it. Like Imam Ali alayhi salam says, if you allow me to sit on the seat of justice, I will not deny an insect its rightful grain. That's the adalat of Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salatu wasalam. That tonight when we think of Karbala, salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Tonight, my brothers and sisters, this balance and equity is in Karbala. The great personalities who went, they went to balance this. Yazid and the Banu Umayyah wanted to imbalance Islam. They wanted to shred the Quran. They wanted to remove the Salah. We know they wanted to remove the Salah because even on the battlefield of Ashura, as we'll talk about it, they did not stop showering arrows on Imam Hussein at the time of Salah. So they wanted to destroy Salah. Do you think they practiced anything of the Quran? They were the antithesis of the Quran. Their power and desire for wealth, Quran condemns it. Just like Fir'aun and Haman. Quran talks about Fir'aun and Haman in Surah Al-Fajr. Exactly was the Bani Umayyah. You want to see how the Bani Umayyah lived, brothers and sisters? Extreme. Muawiyah was a glutton. He used to have an animal stuffed in an animal, stuffed in an animal, stuffed in an animal, coated with chocolate. That's how Muawiyah used to eat and live. He was so decadent, you could not find a person in his era with the level of decadence that he lived. Is this Islam? Is this how the Prophet came and taught us Islam? That we as Muslims, as a ummah, we as non-Muslims, if we're out there, we should never accept such representatives on earth as our role models. In fact, we should look at them as exactly like looking at hell. How to avoid it. People ask about la'na. You said la'na to these people. Please understand, the only definition of la'na is to disassociate. You cannot send a person to hell. I cannot curse you to hell. I cannot say, you, I want you to go to hell. It's not my authority because I am not the master of the day of judgment. Only Allah is the master of the day of judgment. No prophet, no imam can send anyone to hell. Only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who decides that. So when we curse in a symbolic way, it is not to damn and condemn. It is to say, oh Allah, on judgment day, do not put me with that person. That person is furthest away from me. That's what actual meaning of la'an means. It means separation from me. Put it away from me. So when we see this happening in Karbala, you find that the antithesis was on the other side. And the ultimate role models were on the other side. We're talking about Habib ibn Madahir tonight. As you know, Habib ibn Madahir was a companion of Imam Ali alayhi salam. He was a very close disciple of Imam Ali alayhi salam in Kufa. Habib ibn Madahir was one of the first persons to write the letters to Imam Hussein, come to Kufa, we will rise for you. But Habib ibn Madahir, as you know, did not have the opportunity to have Imam Hussein in Kufa. And they say Habib ibn Madahir was of the same age, very similar age as Imam Hussein. They were close friends. They grew up many a times remembering each other. And you find Habib ibn Madahir is sitting in his house. He's got children. And Imam Hussein is in Karbala. And Imam's resonance towards Habib is like his brother. Habib was so close to Imam Hussein. Historians say they were like brothers. And Imam in Karbala realizes that Habib is stuck in Kufa. And he sends him a letter. He sends him a letter. And you find that in the letter, as Habib receives the letter, he knows bad news awaits it. He knows there is bad news coming. Because he reads his letter and he knows that Imam Hussein alayhi salam has been prevented from coming to Kufa because Ibn Ziyad is there and Habib is preparing himself to go. Tonight, we must remember Habib. We must remember Zuhair ibn Qayn. There's a history of Zuhair ibn Qayn also. In these important nights, I will touch on some of these companions. Muslim ibn Awsaja, Uns ibn Harith. These were great companions who came from distant places to join the Blessed Imam. Some were very old, Hufadh of Quran. They had memorized the whole Quran. Habib ibn Madahir is one of those. You find Habib ibn Madahir gets this letter and Imam says, oh Habib, I call you to come to Karbala. And Habib looks at it and says, Inna lillah wa inna ilayhi raji'un. My decree has been set that I must go and fight and support Hussein ibn Ali. Historians say that Habib ibn Madahir had a smile on his face, knowing that he's been given this opportunity to go to Karbala to defend his most beloved leader of the time. Historians say that he had just come from the market. And from the market, he had bought henna. As you know, henna to cover his whiteness of his beard, to give himself that vibrant look, as they say, during that time. He takes the henna and he throws it. He throws the henna. He says, what good is this henna when this beard will be covered with blood? What good is it to color it when it will be covered with blood soon? But look at the willful desire of a man who knows he's going towards his altar of sacrifice, that he knows his beard will be colored with blood. Allahu Akbar. They say in the dark of the night, he arranges an escape with his servant. Some say he took his son with him and his wife was next to him. There's a beautiful story where he looks at his wife and says, I am going to leave. She said, that will be the greatest pleasure to see my husband sacrificing for Hussein ibn Ali. Imagine a woman, a wife, letting go of her husband, bidding him goodbye, the last goodbye. You think it's easy for us to say goodbye to our spouses? Think about that. Do you think it is easy for a woman with that kind of love and that kind of sacrifice, that believe me, in the annals of history, we will not find such examples. That's why these are the best role models. That the woman is giving her husband and he's leaving her, it will never come back. That he gets on a horse with his servant and he escapes in the dark of the night and he arrives in Karbala and he joins Imam Hussein. And historians say that while he was with Imam Hussein, he used to often go to the enemy side and would give them sermons to tell them how wrong they are. Because Habib ibn Madahir was very well recognized to be a very wise man in the community, and the soldiers recognized his greatness, so he was using that to convince them about their wrong maneuvers. They say on the day of Ashura, Imam Hussein alayhi salam split the army into three. Imagine just 72 warriors. There were over 100 people who became shuhada in Karbala. There were 72 warriors, ones who were seasoned fighters, who had fought in some battle prior. There were three flanks.
One flank in the middle was Abbas ibn Ali alayhi salatu wasalam. Hazrat Abbas alayhi salam was the one who was in charge. He was the flag bearer in the center. On one wing was Habib ibn Madahir, and on the other wing was Zuhair ibn Qayn. So Habib ibn Madahir was commanding one entire section of the army, the left side. So imagine the strategy of our blessed Imam splitting the army into three, which sustained resistance from Fajr until after the Asr prayer. SubhanAllah. Only 72 warriors versus 30,000. How do you sustain almost 8 hours of onslaught and you sustain it? Thousands they killed, thousands. Can you imagine the willpower they must have had? Allahu Akbar. We must take that in our time today and to say, oh Allah, give me the willpower of Habib ibn Madahir today. Give me the willpower of Aun and Muhammad that we spoke about yesterday. The ones who could say goodbye to their blessed mother. The ones who could bid goodbye to their uncle. The ones who were not afraid that they were teenagers, but they're ready to go and give themselves. Habib ibn Madahir goes forward. They say he sustained himself for a long period of time, and then when it came time for his moment to go forward, literally to be in the full flank attack on the front lines, they say when Habib ibn Madahir arrived in front of the people, he was chanting this ode. He says, I am Habib, my father is Madahir, a knight on the battle day among the flames of war, by my life. Look, he's doing tabligh. He's doing tabligh even at the last second. By my life, you are more in number, but we are more loyal and patient than you. Our argument is more dominant and clear regarding the truth and more lasting and valid than yours. And Habib started to fight this way. And they say that he killed 62, maybe 65. Some historians have written over 60 enemies by his own hand. Then finally, they say Budail ibn Sarim comes and strikes him on the head. And Habib ibn Madahir falls. He falls from his horse. Then we know that Hasin bin Tamim, as you know, these were wretched, wretched commanders, jumps on Habib ibn Madahir and beheads Habib ibn Madahir and splits his head. Historians say that after Habib ibn Madahir's head was taken on a spear and it entered Kufa, his son from far said, I recognize my father's head on that spear. That they went towards to see their father's blessed heads. But they all went, and as they went, they took permission from the blessed Imam and said, how happy we are that we are going to see our blessed prophet as soon as we are done with this battle. Ala la'natullahi ala al-qawm al-zalimeen. Wa say'alamu al-ladhina thalamu ayyamun qalamin yanqalibun matam Hussain.